My next question is to Alok from Amplus, and what I want to ask you is, a couple of things. Somebody mentioned some time ago that there is absence of incentives to DISCOMs, when consumers are switching over to rooftop solar, and especially these tend to be the creamier consumers who are naturally tending to rooftop solar. So, your thoughts on that, number one. So basically, what is, because it's a genuine concern of the DISCOMs also, they are losing their best customers. So, the first question is, what is being done to address this genuine concern? That's one. And the second thing is, what do you think the government can do more to encourage rooftop solar? Because certainly we are falling behind our targets in rooftop.
So I would say for us, it's a truth that when we do a rooftop projects, there are certain impact on the distribution company's revenue. But the fact we need to look, and they need also need to look at these commercial and industrial consumers. So basically they are paying, they are being so the DISCOM, they supply subsidized power to agriculture or the lower category, the weaker section at the subsidized rates. Now that much amount is being put on commercial and industrial consumer. So one way of finding a solution, start putting, then subsidy, and the reason for subsidizing those people is that they're the distribution system at the tail end, they are always at the tail end. The distribution system is, it's not proper. Losses are very high, and so the cost of service that becomes very, very high for agriculture or these BPL section. So why not start putting distributed, renewable energy sources at the tail end? Don't supply, if you build up a solar system at the tail end, that will improve the system losses. It will also improve the line capacity. So start putting the localized, the distributed sources of energy at those part of the those consumption point. So eventually what will happen? The DISCOM won't be supplying, let's say today supplying X amount of power, then probably they will be supplying X minus Y amount of power. So the burden will again comes down. So that is one way of looking at the picture. Second, is the incentivization part of the DISCOM. So there are many benefits which are being offered by the rooftop solar, and DISCOMs are not able to capitalize in their ARRs. Let's say they have a target of reduction of the system losses. So being a tail end support, there is always being going to be an improvement in the system, the line losses, even at the urban areas as well. So there is no mechanism as such at present which through which they can capture the system improvement, and then they can also show those data as their performance. So that needs to be put in place. That sort of a mechanism needs to be put in place. Plus, like I said, there are highly rated consumer, but they are low rated consumer. And as a developer, my risk is the payment. Risk is the payment. So if DISCOM can, collect the payment in a usual way, they are already billing, they are already supplying to that particular consumer category, and they are taking, collecting the money. Same, I'm also supplying energy to them. I'm ready to pay certain amount of service charges to them, and they can collect the money as usual for my supply of energy, for my amount of energy, and there would be some service charges to the consumer. That's one way of improving their revenue, stabilizing their revenue stream. So in a nutshell, there are a lot of ways people need to look at it, and there has to be a willingness from both the sides. From the developer, we are ready to put our efforts. They also need to be, come and part of our effort. So that is some discussions are already going on, but let's see when the our final output can come.
Very interesting views. If anybody would like to add, please feel free.
Yes, I would like to add, like you have mentioned about the incentivizing. See, currently the situation is that industry is being paid or they need to pay 7.50 rupees per unit. And on the other side, agriculture is getting 1 rupee per unit, for example. So unless and until we make agriculture as a self-sustaining model. For example, if we give solar systems to all agriculture, so there you can say that the levelized per unit cost would be in the range of 3 rupees to 4 rupees, and in that particular case the rate of the industry also will come down in that particular case.
Very valid.
I'd just like to add to whatever has already been said. Although it is really accepted that when an industrial or commercial consumer goes out of the DISCOM or partially starts to partially meet their energy requirement by way of rooftop solar or by way of open access, then of course the creamy paying customer of the DISCOM is lost, and that is a financial loss to the DISCOM. But we also need to appreciate that electricity is one of the key raw materials for the industry, and unless we allow the industry to economize on this particular raw material cost, just like they are able to economize on all the other raw materials, the other government initiatives like Make in India or our exports, they will never be able to come up the way they are planned. Now, one of the ways to address the loss for DISCOMs is to handle or to tackle the loss making side, to tackle the residential or the agricultural consumer side, and that is also one of the areas where solar can help. If the government incentivizes the farmers to adopt solar pump sets, for example, by way of some subsidy or by way of some capital subsidy or capital grant or something like that, then on one hand it will reduce the load on the DISCOM from the agricultural side or from the low paying side, and the need for cross subsidy itself for the DISCOM will come down. Then even the industrial tariff can be reduced even without having them to go and adopt solar.
So since we're talking about DISCOMs, I just wanted to get a sense from the audience here. Do we also evaluate the DISCOMs balance sheets before planning a project in a particular state? For instance, let's say since we are in Gujarat now, Gujarat has debt of about 65,000 crores, and this is perhaps the best DISCOM. I'm talking about GUVNL on a consolidated level. Their top line is roughly about 39,000 crores, and the cost of power is about 29,000, which leaves them with a PAT of just about 600 crores. That's 1% of the top line of Gujarat. Now, this is the health of the best DISCOM in the country, and we are not even going to the Rajasthan's and others. Yes. So you see, with this, we have to be mindful. Of course, all developers here have a strategy. We probably would want to first see how much is the consumption load on the industrial and the commercial customers. If it's more than 50%, let's say it's Maharashtra, let's say it's Gujarat or Tamil Nadu, it makes sense. Rooftop makes sense because that's the creamy layer you want to target. If the industrial and commercial tariff is too high, it again makes sense. If the PLF levels are very high, for instance, parts of Gujarat have recorded GHIs of as high as even 6.1 kilowatt hours per square meter per day, which is very good. So you have to identify these hotspots and only then plan your investments very carefully, and not just go with the crowd.
Well, thank you. I think the common point which is coming, from everybody on the panel is that, the DISCOM should probably look at tightening their own belt. They have enough, there are enough places where they can look inwards and improve their own efficiencies, own operations, cut down their own AT&C losses. And it is because of, continued, maybe mismanagement at their end that the customers are actually forced to look at other alternatives. And, believe me, even when somebody is putting up a solar rooftop, whether it is the customer itself on a CAPEX model or the IPP company on an OPEX model, it is still a big risk that each party is taking. For the customer, it is not his core business. And for the IPP, he is really taking a big credit risk of somebody, it's a big assessment for him. So it is a big risk even for the people doing rooftop. My last final question is on a subject which is very, very topical today, but I must ask, especially because we have representatives from Jinko Solar also, and which is, how real do you think is a threat of anti-dumping duty, and you know, you've mentioned that you have set up factories in India, factories in India also, you know, but how do you think the affected parties are looking at you know, saving themselves or at least minimizing the damage on account, if it at all comes? We are all waiting and watching. So if you can share your thoughts on this, please.
See, Shweta, I mean, I just want to put it other way around. We cannot control this, whether it is happening or not, to be very candid. I mean, we all are discussing about it. We all are trying to push it not to come, because see, if you see current Indian market, we are talking about fantastic 5 to 6 gigawatt upcoming projects, right? So if and the current capacity we have, let me come out of from Jinko and talk as a individual who is aware of the solar market. We don't have that kind of capacities with us to support what is coming up. And looking at the target, what government had set for us, for the country, is something far ahead if we go and get anti-dumping kind of stuff coming in, right? Because it will definitely shoot up the price up to 10 cents straight away in whatever is coming up. And I just want to put one take comment from Mr. Chetan Shah. He very rightly mentioned that we have to be very much aware of the prices now, because the way we have, I mean, we are going towards this tendering, and the way we are trying to bring down the rates. I mean, it looks good, fine. We are achieving 2 rupee PPA or something like that. But are we actually calculating that? Okay, we always talk like, okay, today it is 30 cent, tomorrow it when we negotiate, it will come 2 cent or 3 cent down, right? But what if it goes 6 cent or 7 cent up, and that is what happened today? And now the projects are in vain. So if this anti-dumping comes in, so it will definitely give a killing move to all the tenders which are coming up. And it is not on modules only. I mean, if from Jinko, if I speak, it is not on modules. It is coming on cells also. So it will reflect the same what is reflected on us on an Indian market also. So we are trying to go sit with all the developers and talking to the government to see how we can cope up with this thing.
But is setting up your manufacturing facility in India at all something that you all are considering?
See, setting up a facility in India, we have not given a thought about it as of now. Because see, when we look at setting up a manufacturing, we also have to look around the back end. Do we have that kind of support coming in? How much we have to bring it from overseas market? So tomorrow, if we set up the manufacturing facility also, then again the things will come up via this anti-dumping channel, and we'll face the same scenario which everyone is facing here. So at this point in junction, if anti-dumping comes in, how can we think that all these kind of facilities will come and will support the country?
Also, Shweta, last.
Yes, sir. Sir, you know, just interrupting, I think right now we are on another point of discussion, which is on anti-dumping. We'll come to your question after, you know, we finish this discussion.
I had a question, you know, something related to anti-dumping. What about the conforming to the BIS standard? You know, a lot of consignments are stuck at port as we speak. How quickly do you think, you know, organizations like yourselves would be able to confirm to the BIS norms?
See, as far as BIS, yes, yesterday it got confirmed that we have to have BIS certification done when we want to sell it in India. So we have already taken steps on that, and we were aware of this coming up when it was in the initial stages only. So I hope we'll be, within a month's time, we'll be coming up with something on that.
I think Sheeshnath from Tata Cleantech had was trying to.
I was just making a generic comment on anti-dumping per se. As reading last fiscal year, about 89% of the modules that were installed were imported, mostly China, Malaysia, Taiwan. Had there been no domestic component requirement, it would have been 95%. So what we have done with DGAD. Is that we are trying to artificially increase the market share of domestic players, which could have been better solved if we would have looked at how to improve the capacity utilization of domestic players, how to minimize the cost of the domestic module manufacturers, so on and so forth. So it should not be at the cost of foreign module manufacturers, but there has to be a more collaborative approach is what I think.
Sure. Any other thoughts from the panel? I think, you know, very rightly said, I think the main issue why our Indian manufacturers are not competitive, and, you know, having visited quite a few of the module assembling sites, cum manufacturing sites myself, both in eastern as well as western part of India, and, you know, having interacted with lots of, you know, Japanese players, Chinese players, European players, I think there are maybe three main issues that we see why Indians are not competitive. On a price, quality price perspective, I think for the same quality price for that. One is, of course, the lack of scale. You know, our manufacturing facilities are, you know, at best 300, 400 megawatts in one location on the module side. You know, now there is, of course, Adani, which is putting up a much larger capacity. But in China, you know, all of these are 5,000, 10,000 megawatt, you know, kind of. So the benefits of scale that you derive significantly help you in lowering your input, your per unit costs. The other thing which we have seen and which I have seen is that our manufacturing processes are not, you know, as automatic as probably they are in the foreign countries. You know, ours are either not, you know, very little on the technology side or, you know, semi-automatic. I think the comment that the foreign companies make is that this is a very average kind of a manufacturing process setup. So are there benefits to be derived from fully automating the manufacturing processes? Are the players investing in doing that? And the third thing that we see, of course, is the cost of financing. You know, where Chinese companies certainly benefit from cheaper cost of financing, huge government support, you know, that level of support is clearly not available from the Indian lenders. So these are probably the three things, you know, where many of the domestic manufacturers, we know who they are. You know, there is always a 10% kind of a you know, gap in the prices. So maybe it is, you know, maybe a more holistic, comprehensive solution may be required to address this problem than maybe an anti-dumping, which may not really address the root of the problem. Having said that, now I would like to throw the floor open for Q&A. We'll start with you, sir. You had a query, so please go first.
I am talking regarding the installation of solar power for farmers, because solar power is having the life near about 20-25 years, and a farmer do not know the operation and maintenance. As a developer, someone come out, farmer will give the free land for 100 kilowatts, you have to maintain, you have to install, and you have to provide the power to the farmers at reasonable rate. Is it possible?
Sir, I would like to answer your question. It's possible if the proper ecosystem is there. Like the, you say the land, I get every day a call that I am having 100 or 500 acres of land. Can I put a solar power plant? And my answer is that, do you
I told you farmer will provide the land for 100 kilowatt. And you have to sell the power to the farmers, because farmers don't know anything.
Yeah, I'm coming to your point only. Only giving a land is not the solution. There should be a proper ecosystem wherein the developer or the EPC player should also get a profit out of that. And even a customer, farmer.
You have to do, just like electricity board, you have to do. Only you have to sell the power to the farmers, because farmers don't know ABCD.
Sir, I don't think that it would be possible if it is not properly planned, or if it is not in a ecosystem.
Okay, sir, got the answer. Thank you.
So that's the challenge, going to the farmers and selling power to them. Yes, sir.
I wanted to add something to what sir was just asking. In case we're talking about power requirement to farmers, I think the easier solution could be the requirement of power. If it is only for the purpose of farming, then it is going to be mostly for water pumps. So instead of using a fertile land to prepare to make a solar power plant and utilize a very little power of it, where the balance power cannot be utilized, the better solution could be these farmers could think of a solar water pump which could be self-sustainable for themselves, or there could be micro irrigation systems which could be made within a group of 20 farmers, 50 farmers, 100 farmers, and so on, depending on the location, requirement, water availability, etc. But using a fertile land for a solar power plant would not be an advisable solution, in my opinion.
Thank you very much, sir. Hope that answers your question to some extent. I think that the gentleman has a question.
Hi, myself, Pradeep Verma from Harsha Abacus Solar. My question is for Mr. Alok Verma from Amplus. As a part of joint venture, we have also done almost 30 megawatt solar park in Karnataka. And I believe you are developing a lot of projects in Karnataka. Considering the OPEX benefit under this current open access policy, how do you really see post March 2018, the first, and what will be the next OPEX, open access market for developers as well as EPC players for next financial year?
So if we talk only specific to Karnataka, policies are very clear. The exemptions are only, they will expire on March 2018, and we also understand they are not going to be continued. So we have a clear visibility of the losses and charges. We also have a visibility of the tariff. Still, if I remove all the benefits given to the consumer, and if I can, they are willing to come as a captive, there is always a win-win case for developer as well as a consumer. It depends how the model, how the market is involved, and how the consumers are willing to go for it. Apart from Karnataka, I mean, there are other states like which can be opened up. I mean, we can see, I mean, which are yet to be opened up. There are virtually no open access transaction, like in Uttar Pradesh is there. Then we have a Haryana, there is no solar power transaction. We have a Rajasthan, which is a very limited. So again, it all depends what is the, how the policy takes shape, and how is the, what is the willingness of the government to promote open access. And so that's what will be driving the upcoming market, even in like in Gujarat. So there are, I mean, I would say Gujarat is better because whatever is there, it is very clear. So it's up to us what we want to do, or whether we want to do or we don't want to do. So wherever we can see there is a market, there is a potential for solar, and there is a potential of consumer, the business potential, we can definitely go and start doing business. Anyone can do that.
Just adding to that, one of the tragedies of the overall market scenario is that the few states which are very blessed in terms of solar radiation and demand, for example, Gujarat or Maharashtra, they are claiming to be power surplus. Although a lot of a very large segment of the consumers is not getting power, but still those states are citing excess power, surplus power, and denying open access permissions. Now, if the government is able to enforce RPO, then at least developers like us can set up power plants in these areas and meet the energy requirements of consumers sitting in other locations. If the government can enable these kind of provisions, then the industry can benefit as a whole, and the consumers will also immensely benefit.
Of course. Thank you.
Any further questions from the audience?
We recently we got an inquiry for the asbestos, because we are asbestos company also. We have gone through the whole study of that building. We have taken all the dimensions, locations, and studied, involved 2-3 consultants in that also. It was a very old plant, maybe 40-year old plant. After analyzing the whole thing in, from the perspective of the stability and the ease of working over the roof, we have decided not to go for the solar plant over the asbestos roof. As if we are a manufacturer, our own MD has spoken to the concerned customer and told that as we are the manufacturer of the asbestos, we are don't recommend go for the this solar plant over the asbestos roof. So we have decided to remove the asbestos seat over the roof, and we are installing our metal seat and going ahead with that. Is that answered? Okay.
Thank you. I think we have time for only two more questions. Yeah.
As of now, it's what everybody is saying the same, that there is a rent a roof program, around 20 gigawatt of capacity is planned for it. As of now, there are no clear, we don't know the guidelines and what the way it will be structured. So before, unless the guidelines, the final guidelines come, it is too early to say or to comment on it. And essentially what we see, it is primarily to attract the residential consumers to make them a part of this solar story, solar growth story. So there, of course, there needs to be a push, but we should wait, and we should wait till the final guidelines are published to the in the public domain.
Just to add, to this. So in fact, just to share with you, my own society where I live, we are trying to put solar on our roof. And what we found is, out of maybe 150 nearly flats in our society, there are only about 10 odd people who are kind of a little enthused about this idea. Obviously, no prizes for guessing who was the one who proposed the idea of putting solar rooftop on our society. But, because we are in the sector, we think that everybody in the country knows about solar rooftop. But unfortunately, the truth is that most people are not even aware. That there is also possibility of putting rooftop solar and saving on your electricity bills. So at least, this kind of rent a roof, wherever it is notified, as an idea, it is very, it's a positive idea, because what it does is that it is giving another form of income generation to a society, and obviously adding capacity in the country also. And just to address, one point which one of the panelists mentioned about, the state declaring itself to be surplus despite, pockets not having any power. So, here also the government is taking some steps. So, there are some proposals which hopefully, we are waiting for them when they will get notified, is that they are telling the DISCOMs now to provide 100% power in their distribution license area. So that the customers actually get electricity and the DISCOMs do not resort to load shedding. As you would be aware, when our government gives out the deficit or the surplus rates, they do not count the load shedding
time. So that latent demand, if you see, then we are certainly not in surplus state-wise or even as a country today. And one final question, and then I think we'll break for lunch. We can continue in discussions there. Yes, sir.
Number one, paying electricity from this home. So, is not able to pay. Number two is a limitation in transmission distribution. So, even if we are paid as a power of the plant, this could be to four many things.
That's right, sir. So, what's your question?
Absolutely, that's what we were just discussing some time ago, that load shedding part is not counted while calculating the surplus or deficit. So if you consider that the latent demand, then as a country we are not surplus even today. And You know, I think it's been a very, you know, fruitful session. Thank you very much to all the panelists for their views and thoughts. And thanks to the entire audience for such patience listening. We hope you found the session, you know, helpful. I would like to now close this session and invite all of you for lunch. Thank you.